Alrighty, so welcome to another TCP podcast. My name is BioDevil Dom, and I'm here with many guests and hosts and whatnot. So without any further delays, let's have Renegade introduce himself and go from there. Renegade.
I'm here. I just had to push to unmute. So, hey guys, this is Renegade Operative here. Good to be on TCP podcast yet again.
Mm-hmm. Up next, we have Mr. Captain Chaos. Go ahead and introduce yourself.
What's going on, guys? Glad to be here on yet another podcast.
And since Reapers is here and posting ridiculous pictures, go ahead and introduce yourself.
Hey guys, it's me, Reapers. Just here enjoying my cup of noodles. This podcast in particular is sponsored by Cup of Noodles.
Just a random food. Cup of noodles.
Just a we'll random cup bit.
Of Give us all your fucking money.
That's right.
Up next, we have 563 Gaming. Go ahead and introduce yourself.
What's up? I'm Smoke from 563 Gaming.
Mm-hmm. Up next, we have Jake. Go ahead and introduce yourself.
Hi, everybody. First time here. Glad to be here.
Mm-hmm. And then I think we just have James.
Well, that made me feel good. Oh, it's just James. How's it going? Devil Hunter James here. Good to be back. I think I haven't been on the podcast in a bit, so get back into it.
Yeah, I think I've been missing some stuff too, but it was just relating to the topics that I had no personal knowledge in. But, you know, with that said, I think we can kind of just start working our way with this podcast. So I'm going to start with number two because it's the most relevant one. From all these questions, actually, Tokyo Game Show has passed with a variety with lots of information that came from the show floor. In the following bullet points, we have like Kojima dismissing Metal Gear Survive, not really bringing up much new information on Death Stranding, but he did potentially hint at another playable protagonist. We had Metal Gear Survive gameplay, which will get into depth on that sort of thing. There is the Dark Souls DLC, which we're going to go more in depth on a niche question as far as the gameplay is concerned, but we are going to talk about how it's being considered, at least Dark Souls 3 as a whole, as a quote-unquote final episode. Resident Evil 7 shows off a new trailer focusing on the plot and Baker family. Neo is confirmed to have a release date in February, and then Death Stranding, once again, which apparently has co-op. So what are your guys' thoughts on that?
I'm probably most excited about the Neo news, just the knowing it's going to have a release date now. I think Kojima kind of talking shit about Metal Gear Solid 5, or not 5, but Survive is hilarious, just because, you know, he doesn't want to be associated with that at all. He's just kind of dismissed it, which was great.
He was basically like, how do zombies fit in a game that's about stealth and espionage and political climates and whatnot? Like, how does that even work?
Yeah. I just thought that was great. I don't really know much else about it. I've heard a few things, but I'm not sure if they're true or not. Like some more information about Kingdom Hearts 2.8. I don't know what else there was. Because I didn't see it. It was like apparently at 3 a.m. So I was like, fuck that. But I would have liked to have seen it because it seems like it had the most interesting stuff. But yeah, I can't really speak on too much. That's the only things I know of are Neo and Metal Gear Survive.
I was kind of playing catch up because I was out in San Francisco, which one of the topics is on Resident Evil 7, and I kind of got to play that. But yeah, so I kind of had to catch up with everything a little bit, and I saw like the Berserk gameplay, which it looks fun. It's very disappointing that it's going to be 1080p 30, but I think if it's a consistent 30, that's all that really matters. Actually, one thing that they also confirmed is that there's going to be cutscenes that are in anime form, and then there's going to be cutscenes that are in in-game cutscene form.
I wonder if by anime form they mean the CG from the new Brazil.
No, they mean what they mean by that is the Golden Age arc. That's all the movies. Okay. They're just showing the scenes from the movies, except for I think the Eclipse where the scene kind of just happens. I'm not going to spoil it for anybody that didn't watch Berserk yet. I know what you're talking about. But I think that's in in-game cutscenes. But all the Golden Age arc stuff is in the in movie form or anime form. What else was there? The Resident Evil 7 demo, I had actually saw that while I was away. They had asked me if... they had asked all of us if we had seen it by any chance, because that was something that they showed off the night before. So that was something that was relatively new. Neo, I'm pretty hyped about. Everything's releasing in February, or right around that time. There's Neo, Berserk is also releasing in February. Yakuza Zero releases towards the end of January, I think.
So Nier Automata.
Nier Automata.
That's right, Nier Automata. I forgot to mention that. Fuck.
Yeah.
That's a shame.
A lot of stuff that's coming out around that time. My wallet is just gonna wanna commit Sudoku by the end of it.
It's not over yet. I mean, if you think about it, I think, what is that game? Ghost Recon? That comes out the month after. Mm-hmm.
I don't know about Ghost Recon. I saw the gameplay for it, and I'm just like, I don't know. This does not look as good as it first did, so I'm not too certain on that.
Downgrades are
I don't know. Did you guys see the gameplay for Nier Automata?
No.
It looks like it's kind of weird what they're doing with it. It really does look a lot like Revengeance, just in terms of its gameplay.
It's the director that worked on Revengeance.
So it looks like they took a lot of stuff from Revengeance. It basically is it's a lot like Revengeance, and you can also change the camera angle. So you can change from side scrolling to just have it focused overhead, sort of. So you can
top down.
Yeah, which is a interesting mechanic. I thought was kind of weird, but I guess it could be used in efficient ways. I'm not sure just how you would use that, though. I thought that was a really interesting thing they're going to implement in the game.
Speaking of Metal Gear, I do want to kind of talk about the Survive gameplay. When it came to the gameplay portion, Survive aside and just how Konami has turned Metal Gear into a zombie survival game or whatever, there are some things in that gameplay that I feel as though they should just patch into MGS5 because it would just actually improve the game.
Co-op.
Like the co-op. Yeah, co-op, for instance. The compass thing that they have this little compass icon to show you what direction you're going into. That's a nice little feature I feel as though they could maybe patch in. The map that you pull up on the little iDroid thing is actually a lot better in my opinion compared to the one that's in Phantom Pain. It looks aesthetically better. I think that stuff like that, it looks nice, but the question is, will they? No, actually, no, that question's already answered. They're not going to actually go back and fix MGS5. They're just going to give you zombie games from now on.
It looks like a rehashing, if you ask me, because a lot of people pointed out that it was the same map from MGS5. Nothing has changed, but some small key features here or there.
Yeah, yeah. It's just a foggy environment. The animations are from the, the possessed soldiers whenever you fight the Skull Unit in MGS5. And overall, it's the same locations that are just, maybe slightly destroyed or whatever. Nothing majorly different. It just reskimmed MGS5. So there's... at the end of the day, it's not like they can't patch in some of those, gameplay features into MGS5. Co-op, for example, being the big one. But they're just not going to do it. They're just going to want you to play this stupid zombie game.
All I'm going to say is... go ahead, James.
I was going to say, that's just a cash-in. That's all it is. They don't want to put work into it. I don't even think they have the talent to do anything like that anymore.
So that's why they're... That's why it's a spin-off set in MGS5. They just reskinned it because it would save them a lot more money.
Kojima talking shit on Konami, that was absolutely fantastic.
I had a feeling he'd do that.
Yeah, well, then again, you have to remember, they barred him from events in the past, like the Game Awards last year, I think it was, where he couldn't show up or say anything. Yeah, so that was like sweet revenge, in my opinion. I also think that the Death Stranding concept of co-op, it could be interesting with the way it works with strands. Like, I wonder how that's going to work with the player, but I guess it all is going to depend on the gameplay. Like, we have to see gameplay of this to really judge it.
Quick, I don't mean to interrupt, but how do you guys feel about the game supposedly being open world with co-op involved?
I don't mind.
Because they haven't showed me anything, so I can't really have an opinion about it.
Yeah,
I don't mind the concept, though, because, I mean, we need more co-op games. I think we talked about this subject a couple of days ago where they kind of don't have that many co-op games.
We talked about it yesterday.
It depends on how they implement the co-op.
Yeah, it depends on how they implement it. And, we talked about it yesterday. That lapse of time, I guess I kind of forgot. But anyway, we talked about it yesterday, and I think they do need to implement more co-op games in that vein because we don't have that many. It seems to be a dying breed, in my opinion. And it seems that they're focusing only on multiplayer stuff, which is fine and all, but I would like to see more co-op games.
No, right. I mean, I want to see stuff. I mean, I'm always kind of really disappointed that they didn't show anything. I mean, I know when I was on the chat on the YouTube thing, people were saying, oh, it's only 4% complete. And it's like, yeah, that's true. But I mean, you could have showed another teaser, you know, something else, like, and kind of get more or less what you're going to do with this, you know, other than nothing and give us the same information you kind of gave us before. I mean, there was some new stuff, but the majority of the information he was telling us, if you watched...
Wasn't visual?
No, it was that the shit that he said, some of the stuff he said, he already said in other events.
Do you think that they should have included, like, maybe concept art or something? So
that would have been something new. It would have been interesting.
Yeah, that's what I was like. I wanted them to show us something, but they weren't doing it, and that was kind of disappointing.
Maybe they're not far enough along in developments to show anything like that yet.
Yeah. Before we move on, I do want to hear Smoke's opinions on TGS, if either of you guys saw it and... have any opinions you want to share?
Honestly, I was dealing with a lot of other stuff over the past week, so I kind of tried to, when Ren added me to the podcast like an hour and a half ago, I tried to kind of go on and do a little bit of research to just see some stuff. I watched a couple of the trailers and stuff, but I really didn't keep up with a lot of it.
Okay. What about you, Jake?
Was really interested in the Kingdom Hearts 1, because that's franchise that I really like. But Kingdom Hearts, Gravity Rush 2, and Final Fantasy 15. We got a lot of lore bits for 15, and I think now it's kind of because you guys did the podcast on Kingsglaive recently, right? So I think Kingsglaive is kind of necessary for you to watch before you go into 15 to understand what's going on.
That's correct. And also,
set stuff up.
I want to just say, anybody listening to this, Kingsglaive is actually a really good movie, in my opinion, at least on what the rest of the guys have saw.
Good, but the story elements, I don't think it was the greatest, in my opinion, because it has that tendency to jump from one place to the next really quickly. So it's kind of jarring pacing, but the action scenes are fantastic. End fight is awesome, man.
It's amazing.
How was the Audi product placement?
Ren, you remember there was meats and shit, other stuff?
Yeah, there was. I like the fact that he tried to go reverse with the car down a building. It was so crazy. I loved it.
But it was quite bizarre that there was like medieval cross, like futuristic stuff in there.
Final
Fantasy 13 universe. So
this guy has a cell phone with medieval armor on it. It really didn't make any sense to me. But I like the visuals. The CGI was. It was really good. Good CGI. I would recommend that movie to anyone. I don't think it's as bad as the critics are saying.
Yeah, I don't know why it's getting such bad reviews. Like, I would agree with the plot. Like, the plot does kind of jump from place to place. The action scenes were really good. The CG is almost realistic looking. Voice acting is mostly decent. Jesse Pinkman, though, he's okay. Some scenes he's, you know, kind of but most,
you just can't forget that he's Jesse Pinkman.
Yeah,
I'm a knight, bitch.
For the most part, I thought he was all right. So it's just a pretty decent movie. It's just like, don't go in there expecting to see like any of the main cast from 15. It's mostly just the side characters and just the kingdom that Noctis comes from. So that's mostly what the characters are in the movie.
Don't go in there expecting Shakespeare.
We're right. So we kind of diverged a little bit, but I think that was a really good discussion on TGS and, you know, good discussion on Final Fantasy 15, the Kingsglaive movie. So I'll have James read off the next topic.
Any topic? Yes. All right.
Yep.
Let's see. Oh, I got a good one. The Xbox Scorpio apparently run all first-party games in native 4K. According to Shannon Loftus, and I quote, any games we're making that will launch within the Scorpio timeframe, or making sure that they can natively render 4K, she said. Do you think Scorpio will be capable of this pipe dream, even more impossible, 4K 60fps? Also, they lost that Zen core, that special CPU boost, so they have to find a replacement. To answer that question, no.
Yeah, something PCs tells
can't
me.
Even do that.
I'm
yeah, something
say
tells
this.
Me that they lost that CPU, and it's definitely a lie.
Yeah, I'm gonna say this. If a console has any, like, it's just delusional to think they're gonna be able to, like 4K, even just saying native 4K is already a stretch. But saying 4K 60 frames, like, no. Not
no
even
way.
Most PCs can do that. So you're trying to run, you know, this, it's still inferior hardware to most, you know, budget computers even can run games better.
They got the GTX 2000.
Maybe it's 4K with a slideshow.
Yeah. 4K
that's
Blu-ray,
what it is.
I mean.
But
they got the black market graphics card.
I think say if they do 4K, I think what it's going to be 4K stable 30 maybe, if not like 25 frames or something. It's not going to be a consistent frame rate. But when it comes to like doing the games that they already have that are like maybe like 900p or whatever, maybe they can get like a 1080p 60 frame per second boost, and that could be something that they could have over Sony, where, you know, all they're doing really is just games are getting patched to have a maybe they're getting patched to do HDR so they can be upscaled to 4K, but their frame rate is just going to be a little bit more consistent if they didn't have a consistent frame rate, or if the performance overall is just going to be better on the games. But it's not something that is going to actually improve the games. Whereas the Scorpio could potentially, you know, you can take your old Xbox One games, put them in the Scorpio, and then all of a sudden they can get an improved frame rate and improved, improved resolution. So that's a possibility, but definitely not 4K 60. I can't see that shit working.
No way. I think because the Scorpio is, I mean, it might be a little bit more powerful than the PlayStation Pro, but because it's not equivalent to something that a PC can do, the PC is just a lot more powerful. I think that if anything was going to hit the 4K marker first, it will be the PC, because it's been proven that the 1080 has like 9 teraflops. So if people go around and make this argument, relatively a Scorpio and a PlayStation Pro is weaker than a GTX 1080. So I don't get where people are saying because it's native is going to run at 60 FPS. I don't think it is. I think that mostly, for the most part, is going to run at probably 4K 30, if not upscale, because we haven't seen what the Xbox Scorpio games will look like. If it's going to be upscale, or if they're lying to us, and they only say first party, so they haven't said anything about third party yet.
Right, and I want to interject there too a little bit, because you know, not only that, they haven't said it's only first party, whereas Sony said that if developers want to, they can patch their old games to get that HDR support, to get that PS4 Pro support and whatnot. Microsoft has not said anything about that. And not only that, I think Sony has at least a sales advantage here, because the Pro is releasing this year. It's releasing in November alongside with the Slim, if I'm not mistaken.
That's cool.
Whereas the Scorpio is not releasing until 2 years from now. You know,
They that, have the time, but they won't have the exclusives. That's the problem.
Right. And you know, with that time, you know, yeah, sure, they have the time to develop this console, and maybe they'll have the hardware to do 4K stable 30, right? Not 60, but that they probably would have that. That said, you know, they are going to be losing out as far as what they could potentially do to get a leg over Sony when it comes to selling their upgraded console. But at that point, you know, I wouldn't be surprised if Sony came out with a PS4 Pro Slim at that point, or, you know, if not a PS4 Pro Slim, definitely a PlayStation 4 Super Slim at that point, you know, because I don't see Microsoft really taking advantage as far as like the amount of time they have as far as trying to make up the loss of sales compared to.
It's just a big stretch. Buying, you know? It's a big stretch that they won't make because people, it's just an outlandish claim to see them try. So I don't think they're going to reach 4K 60 at all. It's just a pipe dream.
It just sounds like marketing fluff to me.
Yeah.
And that's the big thing. Like, I mean, for people who don't know, people that just want to play games and stuff, they don't necessarily know that 4K is literally four times the amount of pixels of 1080p. So you're rendering at native four times the amount of pixels, and that takes a lot of power. So if you just like, you're not like a tech head, you don't understand that graphics cards that cost like $400, $500 can't even do that on most AAA titles yet. So you're expecting an entire console that costs maybe $300, $400 to do it. It's just not reasonable. Now, like, you said that Scorpio's coming out in like 2 years. I almost want that because, like, having done some research on the PlayStation Pro, like, I went back to the conference and they didn't really mention about, they were always talking about 4K and 4K, and later on you realize it's actually upscaled 1080p, and they didn't even mention anything about, like, frame rates and stuff. So
Yeah, they basically what it is, it's upscaled 4K. If it's 1080p, it's just upscaled to 4K. The games are not running at 4K. They don't even have an Ultra HD Blu-ray player in there, so there's no way you can actually do 4K gaming.
Right. Also, so what I'm saying is, because there's this emphasis on 4K, imagine I think the PS3 to PS4 era was when the gamers in general were really more interested in give us the frame rates. You know, that's why we have like The Last of Us, that's why we have it remastered in PS4 so they could give you the 60 FPS. And if Sony didn't get that and they're still going with this message in the PS4 Pro saying that, yeah, we're just gonna go with resolution, but we're gonna sack the frame rate, I feel that if Microsoft can capitalize on that, it's going to make that 2 year gap a bit more worth it and maybe help sales wise in the end. But if they're gonna stick with no guys, we're gonna give you native 4K at 30 FPS, we're gonna be like,
that's no point.
The right move.
I wanted to take time to get a little serious on this topic. I mean, I feel like Microsoft's going to play us like a goddamn fiddle, to be honest. Xbox One can't even run games at fucking 1080p. You only get 900p.
I was going to bring up that point. Exactly. I was going to bring up that point because Microsoft, they downgrade a lot of games on the Xbox One. Like Battlefield 1, for example, that's not going to be 1080p 60. That's going to be 720. We've seen games downgraded to like 900p. It's just not going to happen because if this is the next evolution in the Xbox hardware, then why is the last iteration of the Xbox having so many problems with resolution and frame rate? It just... Yeah, it just makes no sense.
It's fucking dumb bullshit. But like, if they somehow like pull some shit out of their ass, I'm gonna say it right now. I'm expecting Red Rings of Death to come back. I'm calling it right now. Red Rings of Death, they are returning.
If they pull it off,
yeah, I can't imagine them not having some technical issues with that console.
Someone's house is gonna get burned down because Xbox.
I mean, Xbox, you know, they had problems with overheating in the 360 with 360. So I mean, this console that's claiming to have it run, you know, really high frame rates, really high resolutions. I can't imagine it not having some overheating issues.
Man, that is hilarious because my PS3, my launch fat PS3, it lasted for about 6 years. And I think that's pretty average for a console life cycle, but the Xbox is, like, the Xbox One in particular had the problems with the disc tray having issues, so I don't expect this to go well at launch either.
I do have to ask, as far as like the way that kind of Sony and Microsoft handled their upgraded consoles or whatever, and how they're just handling what information they spread. How do you feel about, like, you know, Sony just saying, you know, yeah, this console is mostly meant for like games to have better performance on there, for the console overall to just be a better, you know, more beefier PlayStation 4 for those hardcore, you know, gamers that care about that kind of stuff, whereas, you know, just the regular PS4 and the PS4 Slim are for, you know, the casual market. Whereas Microsoft is just kind of going for, yeah, we got all this resolution, we can do 4K 60. We're top dog here, trying to make up the loss of their sales that they lost.
It's just blurbs.
It sounds like they're really trying really, really hard to outdo Sony. I feel like all this is just them trying to one up Sony, and I think they might, you know, maybe they know that they don't have the resources to do all this, and it's not feasible for them to do this. But they're just saying this because they know that it's going to get more attention to Microsoft, but it's probably at the end of the day, it's not going to be true. So
sounds like talk.
It sounds like a bad idea, because when it comes out and then people say, well, they lied, then that hurts them a lot more than, you know, their marketing will.
You know what this reminds me of? It reminds me of when they messed up in 2013. Remember all those bad practices and people didn't like it and people got on their shit and then they changed it? Like, I think lying would make it worse, because people kind of expected you to put up this performance enhancement and you're not following through with it, and then people are going to get angry. So I think they should have just said, you know, we're upscaling to either
1440p or 4K.
Right, yeah. And if you're listening to this and you fucking think that the Xbox Scorpio is good just because it has a 4K Blu-ray player, you're a fucking idiot. Buy a fucking player, not a fucking console.
Oh, yeah. To me, the Blu-ray player, I mean, someone showed a chart really quickly, Dom, before I let you go. Someone showed a chart that the Blu-ray player for DVDs, it didn't even sell that much compared to standard DVDs. So if the argument is, I want this ultra 4K Blu-ray player and the PlayStation Pro doesn't have that, then you must understand that the boom of DVDs, they are still a lot more popular in the standard format. Due to this fact, there was the DVD wars with the Xbox and the PlayStation 2, and the PlayStation 2 outsold because of the games. It's all about the games, people. I mean, hardware is a plus. It does help our graphics from time to time, but it is all about the games. It's all about the exclusives. If you don't have that, and if you don't have something that's up to snuff that can handle these exclusives, then you're going to be left in the dust like Nintendo.
Yeah, and also here's the thing about 4K Blu-rays. You need a 4K television to see the 4K, and it's just like, it's not a lot of people are even, you know, it's just not
it's
a good
it's not a right smart now. Investment at this point
yeah,
in time.
Yeah, like most
no.
people
it is
don't
too
have
expensive.
That. Most yeah, people don't have 4K TVs.
Cost too much.
That's why I can see like Sony being really like, yeah, 4K, 4K this and 4K that, because they actually sell televisions. But Microsoft is like, why are you pushing for it? There's no incentive, especially if you're dedicated.
And if you don't mind me interjecting really quick. In Sony's case, they just said that, like, you know, you don't need the 4K to use the PS4 Pro. It is the PS4 Pro, for the most part, it's either for people that want to do 4K gaming, you know, 4K upscaled gaming, or if
HDR.
You want better performance. Yeah, the HDR. Or if you want the better performance. Microsoft, on the other hand, they're just like, well, if you want the Xbox Scorpio and you're not doing 4K gaming, then there's no point in buying this console. They have no confidence in that console. At least you can give Sony this credit on this point. True. They're at least saying that you can purchase this console and use it for you know, better performance if you're not in 4K gaming right now, if you're not invested in that right now.
All
right. Yep. It means that you don't have to buy a TV, which is, you know, good. I mean, that feature is for people who want that 4K HDR stuff, but at the same time, not everyone has the money to dish out for a 4K TV, so I can see that point of Sony saying, hey, you can use this for however you want, and you get stabilized frame rate in the process, so there's no issue.
frame rate is a little better than resolution, in my opinion.
That's correct.
Yep.
Definitely.
I agree.
So I guess we can move on to the next one since we're finished with that one. Good discussion on that question.
I'll let, why don't we have Jake read off the next one if he's got the doc open?
Yeah, I got it. Anyone, right?
Yeah, anyone you want.
All right, so Recore, the latest title from executive producer Keiji Inafune from Concept, has turned out to be a flop in regards to reviews. People cited that game suffered from extremely long loading times and it was buggy, had difficult AI, cheap enemies, and vast repetition. What are your thoughts on Recore flopping and the overall reaction to fanatics of exclusives saying that you don't need to listen to reviews?
Wait, that game was made by Concept?
Apparently, yes. Yeah.
Oh, that explains why. That explains everything. All right. I know what we're dealing with.
As someone who wants to do reviews, or at least does reviews on the channel and stuff, why... I never see the logic of ever saying that you should never have reviews. That's like saying you should not have more information to make your purchasing decision. If you're making your purchasing decision on one piece of information, you're not being a responsible consumer.
Nope.
It's... The problem is that people see reviews as a means of their game being attacked in this fictional console war, and I don't know why. It's like, if you like a game so much, a review should not hinder you into buying that game. But a review does help the person see what type of traits that game might have before buying it. So if a game has bugs, that's very worrying. It's like, I can't look past a game taking 2 minutes to load tops, or having to load in each segment because the game does not function properly in 2016. I don't know why we got to that point where people think that bugs are acceptable. It just makes no sense to me. And I think it's just because people have brand loyalty to the Xbox and they can't accept that Recore is failing because it's an exclusive.
Yeah. If you don't mind me interjecting here too, like, as someone that has a experimental like kind of series going on right now on my channel, I call it Is It Worth Picking Up? And basically the whole point is to kind of look at the game, look at the ups and the upsides and the downsides to each game that I talk about. And then at the end of it, I talk about whether or not it's worth picking up at the price point that it was listed at launch. And if not, you know, I would give out a recommended price point. And, you know, it's not something that is there to like deter somebody from picking up the game. It is more a recommendation. It is not something that it's like, you know, if the game is bad, of course I'd say no. But at the end of the day, it's more for the consumer. It's giving them the information they need to know and letting them know, hey, this is my personal recommendation. I wouldn't personally recommend picking up this game at, you know, say a full $60 or $40 or whatever. I would recommend picking it up at like, say like $20 or $15 or something like that based on the problems that it has, you know?
Yeah. If you guys remember, this same thing kind of happened when Quantum Break came out. Quantum Break wasn't that good. And the certain people wanted to say that it was the best thing ever because, you know, it was an Xbox exclusive, and they kind of just want something they can point to and say, look, this is amazing, but that's not the case. The game was, you know, either mediocre or average, so it's not, you know, it's just not a good example of an exclusive, you know, a decent exclusive or a system seller, but they want to have one. They want to have, like, to have a game be like, oh, look, this is a system seller. You know, this is why you should buy the system or something. And it's
just, people are in denial.
It is pretty much brand loyalty and denial because they want to, they pretty much want to believe that there is going to be like this game that's going to like save their console. Like, just to have an example they can point to and be like, look, guys, this game was amazing, you know, so this is why you should buy our console. And it's just like, it's just ridiculous, that mentality. It's like, why can't you just play games to have fun? Why do you need to have a game that you can just point to and be like, look, this game is better and we have it, you know, we are the only ones that are able to play it. Like, that mentality is what is ruining this community, I think.
And I think some people need to realize that reviewers don't reviewers don't have a great time reviewing bad games. It's not fun to kind of just have to slog through a bad game to get footage and everything like that. But we try to do it because if you imagine like any random student, any uni student, like $60 is a lot of money. So you don't want them to go and buy Recore. And like if you buy on the Xbox, there's no guarantee you're gonna get a refund. This isn't Steam, and even Steam just had its refund policy like what, a year at most ago. So you do tend to take a lot of risk with all these AAA titles.
Yes, yeah, and I would have to agree. It's especially on the part where you were saying that, yeah, going through a game that's bad, it's not fun. Like, you know, you put in hours and hours and hours of that game, but you do it because, you know, you want to inform the consumers that are interested, possibly interested in the product, or, you know, aren't really sure, they're skeptical on the product. You want to give them as much information as possible.
Yeah, that saying, I just want to say really quickly, because I want to let James go, saying that a product that is bad is good all because you like a console, that is pretty much lies and deceit. Like, I see channels like that, and they are completely, like, clickbait channels. Like, I just don't understand how they operate. So, I always tell it how it is in my reviews. If a game is good or bad, I let people know, and it's up to them if they want to buy it or not. But I do believe that listening to reviews sort of paints a picture of how a game is before you buy it. And I don't think that people are lying if they say that Recore has issues. When I saw them myself, someone named Press Start Kofi, they posted a video of Recore crashing. And I'm like, well, that sort of lines up with what the reviewers are saying with the game having problems and bugs.
Yep.
Monolith has got to fix the shit.
Mm-hmm.
Or test it more. You know those load times were there. Don't say you didn't know those load times were freaking there. Freaking easy fix. Patch it out. Then do it.
What was I going to say before? I was going to say I missed the days when people got their console and they didn't try to push it on other people. They liked what they liked. That was it. You went to your friend's house, you had this console, you had your console, no one had a war about it.
Yeah, definitely.
Nowadays,
like,
it's a bunch of stupid marketing crap that people get all obsessed with, and it makes for very, very toxic fan bases, unfortunately.
Yeah, and to interject too really quick, you know, it's definitely like looking back to the whole like Nintendo versus Sega days, where it was just like, you know, Sega does what Nintendo don't. Like, fun stuff like that is okay, you know, but when it gets to the point where people are just throwing insults just because you don't like a specific console, it's fucking dumb.
Yeah, the landscape has changed. Like, those little jabs back in the past with Nintendo and Sega, those were fun. We didn't even know what the hell blast processing was. Like, we had no idea. So it was just a fancy marketing term. But now it's like, you know, since the internet has evolved and everyone can come out of the woodwork, I think that's what makes it a problem, because there's a lot of toxic people that we're sort of acquainting ourselves with out there on forums and comment sections. So it's unfortunate, but I do believe that there are people that can be rational about what console they play on. I play on PC. I play on PS4. I couldn't be happier. I don't have any reason to get an Xbox because of the Windows 10 integration, and I have Windows 10, so all their exclusives come to me anyway. So that's how I feel about it.
Hmm.
I don't get the logic for why they get so upset that this game is selling well on the Xbox. Like, okay, is that stopping you from enjoying your console?
That's the other thing too.
It's kind of like a cult mentality. It's like, guys, you need to buy this game to help it sell well. You need to support Microsoft.
It's not even like, you know, and I want to kind of add on to that point too, James. It's not even the console too. That can be applied to games too. It's like, you say you don't like a specific game and people get so upset over it. It's really fucking childish.
I mean, all you have to do is say, well, I disagree. That's about it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, or this is like my opinion and this is my preference, and you can't change it because it's my preference. Opinion, man.
Pretty much.
But I guess we can move on to the next one. So I kind of want to read a question off if I can.
Yeah, go for it.
Yeah.
Do it.
Okay, let me see here. Looking through some good ones. Oh, yeah, I got one. So this is number two on trivia. How do you feel about people who try to say that being too old for geek culture and gaming in general is childish to do at an older age?
May I make a quick statement?
Go ahead.
I will probably be buried with my controller. That's how I feel about it. I will be like 90 still playing action games and whatever else I come across. It's redundant. I've seen people go into GameStop that are like 50 years old. They're like parents and they go buy games for themselves. It's ridiculous. It's nonsense.
I feel like everybody has their hobbies, and if they have enough money to support their hobbies while, you know, supporting their livelihood, then why not?
Yeah, well, I just want to say, like, really quick, too, like, you know, like, for me, I don't care what anybody else really says. If they want to, like, say some shit because I play games, then I'd like for them to come up to my face and say it straight to my face. But for me, I don't care, like, I enjoy playing video games. That's something that I've always enjoyed doing ever since I was a kid. And, you know, if it's something that, you know, if I don't have the time to do it, I will try to make the time for it, you know, because I just love doing it so much.
Yeah, I just can't imagine. I mean, you know, maybe the day will come when I just kind of lose interest, but I can't see that happening anytime soon. I'm still... You know, like Dom said, I've been a gamer since I was a kid. You know, I've played games ever since then. I have not really lost any interest in playing games. And just recently, I've kind of taken up the hobby of collecting them and just building a collection of stuff, of games and also anime. I like watching anime. I like talking about anime. I don't really care what people think about that, but, you know, I enjoy doing it. And, you know, the day may come when I may lose interest in that too, but, you know, so like right now, that's all I'm really concerned about is like the here and now. And, you know, like right now I'm pretty interested in it. I've been interested in it for years, so I don't think I'm going to lose interest anytime soon.
I think if anything, like if I were to ever become a parent, which I highly doubt, but in the off chance that I do, I think what I would really like to do is just kind of pass on my hobby to my kid.
Yeah, exactly. I'd do that
too. Like, just to extend that hobby, because it'd be like, I don't know, like a bonding experience, I guess.
It is.
Yeah, it's like I've got all this stuff. Like, you know, why don't you share it with your family? You know, like, that's kind of how I see it.
I mean, I have a little bit of a perspective on this topic, because I'm 30. And I have kids that I have passed on the hobby of gaming to. And I work in an office with varying ages, and it's funny, when I kind of told a few people that I started up my YouTube channel, it was about video games, like the older people thought it was interesting, but they were like, aren't you a little old for games, you know, like isn't that like a kid thing? And I looked at them, I was like, I've been playing video games since Super Mario Bros on NES, like 30 years ago, literally. I mean, you know, like I was practically born with a controller in my hand. So, you know, I don't care how old I get. I'll be playing video games with my grandkids, and they'll be wondering why I'm whooping their ass. You know? So, I mean, I really don't care what people think, you know, about my hobby, because it's my hobby. It's what I like to do in my personal time, you know? So they don't, if they have an opinion on it, oh, well, I don't really give a shit. You know, it's my thing.
And it's interesting that Chaos, you brought up like how you watch anime as well, because anime tends to have this same kind of stigma. And I think what I've always thought about it is that if you think of both anime and gaming in that kind of way, you do such a disservice to all the other types of games. Like, I'm sure all of us have had that game that's like, you know, it's more mature in a sense, like you know that it's not necessarily meant for a child. And the same with anime, and you can't just think that every single game is going to be
right.
That kind of like the ones that's meant for, like Mario, that's meant for children, kind of thing like that.
Yeah, like I feel like people not watching that, they're really kind of, I hate to use this argument, but being closed-minded, because it's like you're really kind of closing yourself off from all. I mean, it's not just a genre in of itself. It's a medium that has like many different genres and stuff. So it's like you're just kind of, you know, shutting yourself out, away from that, which I think is just, you know, I don't understand that. It's like, you know, there's a lot of stuff to that. So I don't know. It just never made sense to me.
The problem is people believe that it is not equivalent to something you would find as being a mature adult. Now, yeah. I know that might sound weird.
No, but I get that. Like, I understand that. I just think it's stupid. But
yeah, people are like, oh, well, when you get a certain age, you have to drop this and you have to be a responsible family man. But you can do all that without having to drop what you love the most. That's what people don't understand when it comes to that. And that's why they're so closed-minded, because like the way I see it, everyone has a hobby. Like, I'm pretty sure if someone says that to me, I'm like, I'm pretty sure you go to the strip club, you go to the spank bank, you watch porn, you do all that weird shit. So I'm like, everyone has a hobby. If you don't, then it doesn't, you don't equate to a human being to me, because everyone has their preferences. Everyone has their kinks. Everyone enjoys doing what they love when they aren't working. So that's how I feel about it. I like the game. I like to read comics. I like to, you know, write and be inspired by stuff. I don't like to just say, I'm going to dictate what this person does in their life because I don't like it. That's just completely stupid to me, because I don't want someone to do that to me.
Yeah. I mean, I play video games. I run a YouTube channel based around video games, yet I still hold down a full-time job. I have a mortgage. I have car payments. I have kids, you know, like it doesn't make any sense to be that closed-minded towards video games. I mean, I get it with some of the older generations, you know, that are up in their like 60s and 70s, you know, they don't really get it too much. But I mean, heck, my dad, who is 55 years old, he plays PS4 and he has a gaming PC, and like me and him will sit there on the phone, because he lives a couple states away from me. Me and him will sit there on the phone for hours discussing video games, like, you know, what he's been playing, what I've been playing. He keeps up with the channel, you know, like, and we'll sit there and discuss things. And like I said, he's 55. So like, you know, there's no age limit to loving video games.
That is the best dad ever.
Awesome. I actually saw on YouTube, I think it was like some 80-year-old woman playing like Skyrim or something. Like, she's like 80 or something.
Yeah. They've been showing, like, since we're kind of talking about like ages in video games and whatnot, there have been like news reports on, like, you know, very elderly people getting into video games, you know, just because it kind of helps them cope with like certain, like, you know, illnesses and whatnot. And some of them just like doing it just because they have grandkids and things like that. Some of them have just been gaming since like way back in the day when gaming was first prevalent. And, you know, they'll say like, you know, I'm not as good as how I used to be, you know, when I was much younger, but I still like playing and enjoying the hobby, you know, even at this particular age.
Yeah.
I think it's really interesting to know that the cavemen that walked with the dinosaurs were gaming as well, and they still are. I think that's really great.
Science.
Yeah, science for the win.
So they could play Grand Theft Auto.
That's right.
So, I think that was a pretty good discussion on that topic. So I'll go ahead and take the next question. I'm actually going to take this other trivia question. This is from me. So, with mods becoming a big topic in the console market, what games would you like to see have mod support, and for what console or platform, rather, that isn't PC?
Street Fighter V.
DMC4. Give it to me. Please.
You need skins. Skins are fucking awesome. The Street Fighter
I was going to say, yeah, the same thing. That's pretty much a DMC gets the skins and special effects.
DMC4 SE definitely needs that mod support. I think Resident Evil Remake HD had some mod support too, for like skins, where they like gave like the classic PS1 skins or PS1 style skins. I'm not sure if they modded in any of the other costumes that were in other versions of Resident Evil 1, but that's something that I would like to see. And then let's see. Actually, I would like to see a lot of like mod support for like the Souls games on PS4. That'd be pretty nice.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I guess I could agree with that one. I guess like most Bethesda games, I suppose, because they really don't have a lot of like they're doing it apparently for Xbox One for Fallout 4, but PS4 isn't doing it or something. So
yeah, Sony said no.
Yeah. But yeah, I guess I would like to see that. I mean, it does. It's kind of. It doesn't really matter to me because I've got a PC. So if I really wanted mods, I could just, you know, do it.
That's true. I just think of it like as a way of like when I was playing Street Fighter 4 on PS4, I didn't have all these awesome mods, these cool skins, you know. So I decided to get it on PC. But if you know, if you had it on there, you wouldn't feel like restricted to get things like the. And I feel like any game that has like issues, I feel like mods. Always find a way to fix it, and you end up getting like a fix, like the DS,
like fix a fan patch.
Yeah, for like Dark Souls 1 on the PC, they can get like a mod fix for it. For any game on the console that has issues, I'm pretty sure mods would find a way to fix it.
Would that also apply to like fan translations too?
Yes, just but probably. I doubt they would let them do that.
Yeah, that would be pretty sick. If you could actually do that, you know, like easily implement a fan translation patch thing, something like that.
I don't know why they wouldn't let people do that. They would be saving them money in the first place.
Yeah, and it even gives them like an indication of how much interest there is overseas, kind of thing. Like lots of Japanese games don't come to the West because they think, oh, you know, the West doesn't want it. But actually, the West is like, give it to us.
Yeah, to be fair, I think Sony is realizing how many people like Yakuza, because Yakuza 0 and Yakuza 6 has, or well, not 6, but 5.
6? Five got a digital release. 0's coming out for PS4 with a physical release. And 6 is being talked about for a potential localization.
That's great.
No word on Kiwami. Still no word on a localization for the HD collection, which really needs to happen.
Yeah, but I would think that needs to be prioritized over pretty much everything else, because that's really where people need to start with the Yakuza series.
Man, Yakuza is amazing. Anybody that
especially since 2 is so hard to find.
Yeah.
That'd be awesome. I could be able to play Persona 5 right now if that was a thing, but it's not, so I can't. Yeah. Well.
How do you feel about this, Ren?
What about you, Jake, since Ren's dead?
What, the mod spot? Yeah, no, I mean, like, fan translations, definitely. Like, even mods could even give, like, you add that extra layer of community into your games, and you make it a little bit more, how to say this, you could make it accessible to a little bit more people, because the mods would be able to be, like, you know, they're not just developers, not just corporations, they're real people that find that, well, maybe there's an issue or maybe something that they like in that they want to have in a particular game. And I don't see why any platform would want to avoid that.
Mm. Okay, I'm back. So we're talking about mod support?
Yes, mod support on consoles. Are there any specific games on specific platforms that you'd like to see getting mod support?
Maybe like stuff like Last of Us, I think Infamous Second Son, that'd be pretty great to see all the crazy powers and skins you could put in. Probably a Spider-Man skin, some crazy stuff like that. I think that mods on consoles are important because, like I said, there are those mods that does fix some bad games, or it does. It probably will help with the whole patching process too, because you know, sometimes we have to wait on a patch for a game to come. When the fans could do it themselves. So I don't see why they don't implement this feature where it could help out their games more than they think it will.
Yeah.
So that's what I think, because, you know, Sony just saying no, they really didn't give a good excuse as to why. They didn't say anything to Bethesda at all. All they said was, no, we're not doing it, even though I think it was last year where Bethesda had their conference and they sort of said that they were going to have mods across the board for Fallout 4.
Yeah, apparently what happened was Bethesda didn't want to test the mods. Like Sony was telling them, okay, if you want to do this, you need to test out and make sure all the mods are not going to like hack into the system and make like fucking hacks and shit. Mm-hmm. And they didn't want to do that. They're like, no, we're not going to do that. And then they're like, well, then no mods.
So it seems like an ultimatum.
Which, if that's the case, I don't think that's so much of a problem. But they need to clarify that first, you know, before saying, you know, no, and just not really talking much about it, you know. I think they need to clarify that, hey, you know, if your games, if you want to have mod support on our console, you need to make sure that they won't hack into our software and whatnot.
Right.
Apparently, yeah, Sony. Good.
Apparently also, but when Bethesda made that announcement, they didn't even talk to Sony about it. Like, they basically said it, hoping that they would say yes to it. And they didn't. They were like, that's great and all, but you guys need to test it. Like, if something happens, we're not taking the blame for it. You know, it's going to be on you. It's not going to be on us. And they didn't want to do that.
The only thing is that Sony has been very apologetic in terms of their infrastructure being hacked into. So, you know, I figured even though they said no to this, they will have some common courtesy to say as to why, because of all the stuff that happened in the past when they got hacked, when they had to give out free games to people. For the most part, I do hope that they allow mods in some form, or if companies are more open to the idea than Bethesda, because the problem now is that because they said no, it just makes them look bad without any explanation as to why they said that.
Right. So are there any final thoughts before we move on to the next topic?
You guys pretty much covered. I mean, the only other thing I could see is maybe some like fan-made skins for Overwatch. I've seen some stuff online that would be pretty cool to implement in Overwatch.
Yeah, I've seen some stuff too.
Like, there's people that even like create entire new characters and concepts. Like, there's dogs and stuff like that.
Yeah, I've seen a lot of cool like concepts online that could have been implemented in Overwatch through a mod system that would have been really fun. But so I'd like to see mods for that on PS4. That'd be pretty cool.
The fans help so much; they really do.
Actually, that reminds me. I was noticing when I started playing Darkest Dungeon a few weeks. Well, however, when I started it. Great game, by the way. I noticed a lot of the mods for that game. There was a lot of... They have class mods. Like, they made their own characters that weren't in the game. So I think that kind of stuff is amazing. I always like when the fans try and, you know, add on to the creator's will, so to speak.
And I think people, to really, like, solidify the potential that mods actually have, I think Dota 1 was a Warcraft 3 mod, and then that's how, you know, it came from that and then became the big giant that it is now. So there is like an entire kind of genre creator itself came from just the mod of another genre.
Yep, that's how ideas get created and inspired on. That's why I don't think it's a bad idea. Like, if your mod can create something totally new, that's a new experience, then that's when you know you succeeded in game design.
I mean, a mod saved Dark Souls 1 on PC.
True.
Microsoft wasn't good at doing console support, so I think the guy who made DSFix got a personal thank you from FromSoft, if I'm not mistaken, way back when.
So. Thank you for fixing our broken port.
Well, yeah, pretty
well, much. Weren't they not familiar with PC at the time?
They weren't familiar, and it wasn't planned. They did not plan to do it. They did it because the fans wanted them to do it, so they said, okay, we will give you the game as best we can. Which, since they didn't know how to work with PC, they, you know...
I think in that case... They did what they could. Sorry. I think in that case, they should have had, like, another company handle it, the port, the PC port.
Yeah, I could have seen them doing that, but I'm glad it turned out for the best. Yeah.
Anyway, I think we covered this topic pretty nicely, so I'm going to have Smoke read off the next question.
All right.
Any question you want. All
right. I'm going to do number 4. Steam review scores have recently changed to ward off playing the system. There are now several filters in play where the keys of the user activating the game, the native language, and choosing between the particular reviews between known reviewers and user scores are taken into account. Valve explained that the update comes as a preventative measure against very illegitimate reviews since people have become so fixated with review scores. How do you feel about the new policy? And there's a bullet point that says, to add on to this, devs have to look to Twitter to show their concerns about Valve making sweeping changes with game developers, citing how it was an update that took us by storm. I don't really know how I feel about that too much, because I mean, I'm not, I can see where it might impact game developers a lot. I mean, I read a lot of reviews, but I mostly go to YouTube for reviews on games, so it doesn't really affect me too much. Because I'm a very visual person. I'd rather see the gameplay and hear somebody's thoughts about it. And I'll do a lot of research that way rather than read a whole ton of reviews on Steam before buying a game.
That's kind of how I am about it. But yeah, I think that's a pretty good idea. Just so people can sort of filter out the good reviews from people just, you know, being trolls and, you know, saying, you know, because there's a lot of trolling that goes on in Steam reviews with certain games. It's like, you know, just give a really bad game, like a review, like, oh, best game ever or something like that. And just, you see a lot of that kind of stuff. So I think that's a good idea.
And even, like, even not to differentiate the genuine ones from the trolls, you even have like some of the filters are like finding out if it's by key activation instead of by purchase. So what that means is if you get review copies or you get it from things like instead of purchasing the game, lots of people think that, I mean, there are lots of people on YouTube that think that once you get something for free, you can no longer be quote unquote objective when you review it. So having that filter actually helps those people, I suppose, get rid of that worry.
Yeah.
Yeah, I can see that.
Yeah, I guess it proves this a little bit more legitimate than to listen to people who either read trollers' reviews. I mean, it is good to have the filter there because some people, they tend to really be fixated on reviews. So if you want to listen to the user reviews, you should be able to do that. If you want to listen to the people who are big time reviewers, I mean, you should be able to do that too, or use your own judgment and buy the game yourself. I think that will be a great indicator as well. That's actually the best one as opposed to listening to reviews. So it is really good. And I don't think that game devs should be scared of this particular system being implemented, because I figure if you know your game is something to be played and something that is good, you wouldn't be scared in the first place. You would have that confidence of people getting their hands on time with it.
I think the only devs that are probably scared are the ones making the really crappy games out there that, you know, hire a bunch of trolls to go on there and promote their game and get people to buy them and, you know, just to make them money. Because, I mean, that happens all the time. So
yeah,
that's mostly Steam Greenlight is mostly to blame for that. There's a lot of crap that gets through that. It's kind of a double-edged sword, though, because it's good for, like, people that want to put their games out there, but then there's people who just have these really crappy games that they don't really put much effort into, and they can easily get it on Steam.
Crap, so. 60.
Oh, God. Don't.
Yeah, it's unfortunate, but, you know, like I said, it is good for the people who want to read that sort of stuff, read between what legitimate people are saying and what the users are saying. So I don't think it's bad at all. I just think that people freaking out about it, you should have more confidence in your games.
Yeah, I mean, when I do look through the Steam reviews a little bit, so, you know, it, if it does help cut out a lot of the trolling and the bullshit reviews, then, you know, I'd say, yeah, it's definitely a good thing, because it'll save, you know, anybody that's really interested in buying a game a lot of time.
Yeah, I definitely agree.
All right, so I think we can move on to the next one. So who didn't go yet?
We didn't have Chaos read off.
Okay.
Or actually, no. We didn't have Reapers read off the question. Sorry about that.
That's all right.
I'll let Chaos go. I'll go after him.
Okay, cool.
All right. Let's see. What the fuck? I guess I'll go with number 10. What the hell is this? Silent Hill Broken Covenant was apparently confirmed as a title to be in development for the PlayStation 3. The Lost in Concept feature is similar to Silent Hill 4, like purifying rooms with holy elements and items. Along with added stealth elements, and winter was going to be a big factor in fighting enemies, as well as using a truck to fight. What the What are your thoughts around this Lost in concept? And then there's a video link I did.
Could I talk about this?
Yeah, I have no idea what the hell this is.
So all of that is true. They say it in the video. They say there was going to be...
Hold on. Yeah. I have many questions. Why is this in development for the PlayStation 3?
Wasn't it supposed to be like a launch title or something like that?
Is this going to like not come out?
No. It was in development before it got scrapped. It was in development in 2006.
Why are we talking about this now, if it got scrapped?
Because they showed a video on it recently that they had a concept for a Silent Hill game in 2006 and it never came out.
I do want to share my opinion on that really quick. So when it comes to this bit of news, I think some of that actually made its way into another Silent Hill game, if I'm not mistaken. The whole like winter aspect or whatever, wasn't that in
Shattered
Memories? Yeah, the one where it was like a really bad remake of the original.
It wasn't even a remake, it was a complete reimagining of the original.
Yeah, and the truck thing sounds really weird.
Yeah,
but,
it's Origins.
Were we gonna play as the character from Origins, using his truck as a
death vehicle?
It's fucking Twisted Metal.
This
for a hillbilly moment.
But then again, wasn't there the whole thing about like it supposedly taking concepts from 4 and just expanding on that?
Yes. I doubt it.
So I think, you know, that idea, that sounds cool. You know, expanding on what 4 had left off, like, gameplay-wise and story-wise, and just kind of expanding on that, that doesn't sound like a bad idea. But doing all this other stuff, like having the winter being a very big, impactful thing for Silent Hill, of all things, and then just having the truck and shit, like, that sounds stupid.
Well, we have had Silent Hill Dungeon Crawler, so... You know, you can't get more stupid than that.
Look, gentlemen, this series is now a pachinko machine game.
Yeah.
Solid Metal Gear.
I mean, Team Silent, here's what I have to say. If Team Silent isn't working on the series anymore, it's not Silent Hill. Like, you know, it was Team Silent and Kojima have both, you know, they're no longer going to be doing Silent Hill games, so... Yeah, well, not implying Kojima did Silent Hill games, but he was going to, so...
And his was supposed to be taking in concepts from the first 4 games, and then the things that worked in the later games, he was going to take and just kind of use those as like backdrops, I guess. But he was going to kind of stray away from using like all the stuff that made Silent Hill kind of turn into crap, which is why a lot of people were looking forward to Silent Hills. Because it was going to be a revitalization of that franchise, and it probably would have turned out really well because, you know, obviously Kojima didn't want to just keep doing Metal Gear.
Yeah, it's a shame. Like, it would have really revived the series, but nope. It sounds like they took the concepts from that game and just put it into the other, not Downpour, but Shattered Memories and Origins. Instead of, you know, whatever the hell they were making with whatever that was supposed to be with you can run over enemies with a fucking truck.
Yeah, wasn't Shattered Memories, didn't that come out in 2007?
Yeah, I believe so.
So it was a year later, so yeah, that could have been
an early Wii title or something.
Yeah.
I think so.
Yeah, it was on Wii and then it was on the PS2, I think.
Yes, it was.
Yeah. But yeah. By the way, it's an interesting game, but I like that they tried to do something different, but it's just not good what they tried to do. I'll just say that.
It doesn't sound like something you would see in Silent Hill.
That's
where
in general like what
truck.
They did with the series after 4, doing something different, but it not being good. Like
being
the
very
crawler.
Out of place. Right?
Oh, you're talking about Homecoming and Downpour.
Yeah.
Oh,
well, Downpour, it tried to give you like all these side missions and stuff. Like it tried to act like a I don't know if I'd say like an MMO or something, but it's kind of felt like that because it's like there's all these side missions that there's really no incentive to do them, and.
Wasn't Downpour considered to be a decent Silent Hill game
it
after
was,
4.
But I... It's
not
I,
terrible.
It's not terrible, but I really don't think it's not Silent Hill.
The frame rate of that game is horrible. I have terrible. It. That's it's
the
terrible.
The combat that's is the awful, horror. Too. I'll say that.
The scary part is not the frame rate. The horror part.
God, that frame rate. Yeah, talk
and
about
the
running
story
around.
Is also... I'm just not good. Like, they really just took the story from 2 and... You know, just it's like
hold
that's
on.
All they did with the other Silent Hill games. Is
hold
they
on, hold on, hold on.
Yeah,
Chaos. They were actually going to implement Pyramid Head in that game.
The game they were talking about.
Didn't
yes, yes.
They do that with every fucking iteration of the series now. The Pyramid
James
Head.
James monster. No one else's. Now he's just the king of.
It just doesn't
games.
Make
yeah,
any
James
sense.
James is monster.
Is my monster.
Yeah. If you add Pyramid Head to your Silent Hill game, you already fucked up.
Yeah.
Hello, Homecoming.
Unless you're gonna do a game about his, well, no, that still doesn't make any sense. Yeah, it just have to be about James. Like,
you know, he wasn't in that Konami racing game that's really old. He was a character to play as.
He was in the dungeon crawler too. He was an enemy.
Ugh.
They made the boogeyman from Downpour an enemy in that.
How?
He's the most powerful enemy in that game.
Guys, see,
man,
you need to get on the podcast.
That is, that's weird.
Yeah.
Well, that whole concept is weird, like Silent Hill Dungeon Crawler. And I blame Tom Hewlett.
I want a real Silent Hill game, like a good one.
Well,
oh,
we were
going to waiting
that.
A very long time, my friend.
Well, we're not going to get that. It's not going to happen anymore.
If we're talking about the now, though, we're not getting that.
No.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks.
Not unless there's going to be some kind of fan project that is going to like be real passionate
be
about
canceled.
Trying to make another sound. Or sound
is that
again.
Fan Kojima?
Oh, that's going to be shut down. DMCA.
Man,
that's
like
yeah, cease
though,
and desist
thing.
From fucking Konami.
What I would actually, you know what? If there is an indie dev that's out there that's watching this right now, what I would personally recommend is if you want to make basically. A return to form Silent Hill, make a spiritual successor at this point.
Also, yeah. Don't tell anybody that you're making it. Tell people when it's already out and it's already
well, no, that's why I'm saying make a spiritual successor, because if you make the successor, you don't have to worry about it getting shut down. As long as it's its own thing that's inspired by Silent Hill, it should be fine.
Resident
this
Hills.
Is actually one thing that I will give the Resident Evil 2 Reborn, the fan remake team, some credit. At least they didn't scrap everything from that fan Resident Evil 2 remake. They decided to take that and make a whole new project out of that. So, you know, do something like that where you just make a whole new IP rather than just remake, you know, Silent Hill or make your own Silent Hill. So that way you don't have to worry about it getting taken down from Konami or, you know, whoever, if Konami even wants to own it anymore.
Konami is going to hold on to that franchise for dear life. They're going to hold on to the rights to it. They're going to be one of those people who is like, you know, you can't have it. It's ours. And we're not going to do anything with it.
Well, when they go under those IPs, they'll come back, maybe. Yo, didn't they say that crap where they want to win the fans back? You know what would win the fans back? Either do something with it or give it to a company that will. Sony. That would make people happy.
You can say that about, you know, like Metal Gear, like do something with it or don't do anything with it at all. And look at what they did. They made Survive and they made a pachinko machine of 3 with
in
the
this
Fox
case,
engine.
In the, I meant like an actual game, but in this case, I say please get away. Or I know it's going to sound stupid, but I'd rather Kojima have it and do nothing with it than them have it and screw it up.
Oh, hey, breaking news.
What?
Breaking news.
Yes.
Really quickly, I have to interject with this. Remember, Capcom wants to be the number one developer in the world.
Wait, please God tell me that was a joke.
No, they want to be they want to be the very best that no one ever was.
All right, Ash Ketchum, make me Devil May Cry 5 and you'll be on your way.
As much as I like Street Fighter 5, you guys really fucked up with not letting me play it on PC until right at this moment.
No, Reapers, you don't understand. They're the best.
They screw up before
the
that.
They can't screw up.
Oh, sorry, yeah, you want to be mad?
They're exactly like Ash Ketchum. I will say they're exactly like Ash Ketchum though, because
they want to be the very best, and like 95% of the time they fail.
This is not the fucking golden age where Capcom like could fucking shit out a turd and it will be gold. It's not that age anymore. The PlayStation 1 and the Dreamcast and the PS2. Capcom has done a lot of shady shit in the PS3 era, and it spilled over DLC. Worse into the PS4. Yeah, with the on this DLC stuff, I mean.
Well, they held the low for that.
Yeah, they really did. And now it's like they try to put out IPs, but they just aren't as good as their previous IPs before. So it's something that they need to fix as a problem.
Just listen to the fans. That's it. That's your ticket. Listen to what people are telling you. I don't know why they refuse to.
Remember when they were talking about Resident Evil or Resident Evil 2, and they're like, so what do you guys think? Do you want Resident Evil 2 HD?
What kind of?
Yeah, they asked like two times. They had like two surveys.
People
have
been asking for it for years. And they're like, people want that game for years. You want one or not? I'm not sure.
Yeah, let's dangle it in front of your face like a carrot.
I get you to yell them for 10 years and they listen, which is stupid.
Oh, so people actually want it? I didn't know.
You don't say.
Now it's all just a matter of will they do right by the fans with that remake, but we're kind of digressing a little bit. We went from Konami to Capcom.
I just wanted to say that because that is not in the document, and I wanted to say that because that's the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard today.
Oh yeah, no, yeah, believe me, it is. You know, they are literally like Ash Ketchum. Like 75 to 95% of their attempts are end up in failure, and the other 5% is the very rare chance where they actually succeed in something. And it sucks because I don't want to be that person to say, hey, you know, Capcom, you suck as a company. But at the end of the day, you know, as somebody that, you know, loves their games and loves their franchises and loves what they did back in the day, you know, it's like you can't help but try to give them that tough love where it's like, you know, you can't, you know, get the appraisal all the time. You need to be kind of put into check, at least until we can be confident with how you handle things.
That's how you get better.
I just said that's how you get better. That's all I gotta say.
I just want Capcom to drop the, I pretty much talk is cheap. I'm sick of hearing them say things. I want them to actually go do something.
Yeah, I agree with that. Alright, so I guess we can move on to the next one. Who wants to read off the next one?
I got it.
Go for it.
Speaking of fan-made games, Nintendo recently posted an advertisement stating that they are actively hiring people to take down unauthorized games and projects. That includes intellectual property enforcement against any fan remake. What are your thoughts on this? I think it's stupid bullshit that they have to do it.
Wait, who did?
Nintendo.
Nintendo Heroes.
What else is new? Nintendo is the king of
Nintendo Heroes.
They Nintendo sucks. I'm sorry. They can't. They hate the fans. I'm sorry.
Let's give them the benefit of the doubt. At least they are hiring people.
They take YouTube money now. They're doing this show.
So what? Like, wait. Excuse me. It's so weird. So what are they hiring for exactly?
If you're like Metroid Prime, that one fan game is like, if the people they hire catch wind of it, they do the cease and desist.
What? But this, okay, but didn't they say they were open to fans doing fan remakes?
That was a lie, Don.
Wait, hello, Pokemon Just Uranium, kidding. That's a great game. Oh, season this.
You know what?
Metroid, same thing.
You know what they should be doing? You know what they should be doing? They should be like, hey, you know, you went and took the time, you know, to make this game, whether it be a remake or your own variation based on our franchise that we own, right? Why don't you come work for us and actually help us work on these games?
You get a dollar every game you take down. your reputation gets points. You get points for your reputation.
Oh my god, no.
You get to go to the Nintendo Heroes Meeting Summit and fucking
god.
Glasses of water and bread.
you can mass flag Nintendo. Games.
Yeah, welcome to the Scum Club.
At this at this point, the Nintendo that we knew, which was Mario, is starting to slowly turn into a fat but buff Wario, stealing their guys' money.
Oh my god, that is...
What you're saying is Nintendo farts all day.
Our company's doing this shit, though. Like, fucking first YouTube and now Nintendo. It's like, god, well, why are such stupid people running these corporations? Like,
it's not going to make you look good. Getting crappy these days.
Just want to do a personal service announcement to anybody that's trying to make a fan game. If you're going to make a fan game and don't want anybody to cease and desist, I would suggest that you don't tell anybody about the game until it's made and it's already out there. So by the time that they tell you to cease and desist it, it's already too late.
But see, we kind of talked about this already, and that's why I suggested it's best to just make a spiritual successor, because you can do that. You know, you can make that particular game. And at the end of the day, though, it's like, you know, if you do it that way, you can make a whole new franchise and you can be profiting off of something that Nintendo or Sony or Microsoft or whatever company we're talking about. You know, you can make a profit off of what they're losing out on, you know?
I could test. We've seen both before. I mean, like,
good.
Look, I was just going to say, like, remember the Streets of Rage remake? Sega DMCA'd that. And they put it out anyway because the game was already finished.
Yeah, Capcom did that with Mega Man Cross Street Fighter.
So this game is going to be called Not Mega Man?
Man, Capcom just wanted to profit off that shit. That's why they say, you know what? This guy, he's a real fucking hero. He's going to, you know, have his game with us. We're going to give him some money.
That was on the anniversary, and they didn't have a game to put out, so they're like, fuck it.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, what, Street Fighter Mega Man?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
But didn't they also say that, like, you know, as far as, like, the Mega Man thing was concerned, like, they were asking about it if, like, people want Mega Man, and they were pretty much doing it the same way they did, like, Resident Evil, where they asked and they weren't really sure. You know, maybe they'll do, like, a Mega Man X collection, kind of like what they did with regular Mega Man, and then they'd be like, oh, people actually want Mega Man. Maybe we should make a Mega Man. And I do want to clarify, too, it's like, I've spoken with PR members from Capcom while I was over at San Francisco, and they are definitely, like, understanding as far as, like, you know, people wanting stuff, but it's not really up to them. It's up to the higher-ups. So if there's anybody you really want to, you know, kind of give fire to, it's really more of the higher-ups.
So you mean the publishers?
Yeah, because it's not, like, the PR members, they're just telling you all the information they really are allowed to tell you, and just kind of informing you as far as, like, informing you about their products and whatnot. They don't really get to have a say in what gets made and what doesn't.
Right.
Isn't that why a lot of publishers and developers butt heads, because of creative differences?
I believe so, yes.
I figured.
But going off what Dom said about the spiritual successors, I mean, there's some people that can do that, and there's some people that strictly just want to do HD remakes. Like, remember the one for Metal Gear Solid 1? That didn't happen.
The one that was on Unreal 4, or no? Are you talking about the one for Metal Gear 1 that they had, like, David Hayter do the voice of both Solid Snake and Big Boss?
Yeah,
that was supposed to happen, and I think Kojima Productions LA was going to help kind of handle that. You know, as far as, like, the development and stuff like that goes, which for whatever reason Konami didn't try to bank off of that either, and they just completely canned that. So, you know,
they're trying to do it for RE2.
RE2, what they had done, which I thought they brought on people and hired people on there, but what they did instead was they flew over that fan team and just asked for, like, feedback. So that might influence or have some sort of form of influence on that particular project. But that particular... Huh?
They couldn't just email them? We got to fly over to talk?
I don't know what else they did. You know, maybe they kind of had, like, a really long sit down, huge meeting about it and whatnot. I don't know. But what that team ended up doing eventually was they went out and they got somebody from Capcom, former Capcom employee or something like that. They're helping them out with their current game that they're working on, which is Daymare 1998, which I still need to do a video on, but you know, they took Resident Evil 2 remake, the fan remake, and then they just made a different thing. So, you know, it kind of all worked out in the end.
Mm-hmm. All right, so that was a good discussion. So I think we should move on to the next one. So
I'll take the next one since I didn't really read anything. I'm actually going to do a niche question. So I'm going to do number one. There was a new Berserk and the Band of the Hawk, which that's the full name of the game now, gameplay for Serpico, and then there's also screenshots of Griffith, specifically in his Femto form. Also, the release date for Berserk is set for February. I think it's like February 24th, 2017. Will you be picking up the game at launch?
If I had the money, I'll try, but no promises.
Most likely getting on PC.
I will hook you up.
I love you.
Can I give a big fuck you to February? Holy shit.
No, Persona's not that big.
Dude, there's so many games coming out that month. Some stuff is getting skipped.
Yeah, it was in February too. Good lord.
Some of that stuff, like Yakuza 0 comes out towards the end of January. So it's like, you know, there is so much stuff around that time. My wallet, like I said, is going to commit Sudoku, okay? It doesn't want to live anymore.
My birthday's in February, so I'm just going to be telling, like, everybody, you know, I want you to get me this. I want you to get me that.
Right. Mine is trying
try to lessen the impact on my wallet.
Kid in the candy store.
You know, the good things about being single is you don't have to worry about getting anybody presents or anything on February. You can just get it for yourself.
I was about to say.
Yeah.
Hmm.
But yeah, I'm going to get it on PC. Unfortunately, what I'm hearing is that on the console, it's only 30 frames. So I might as well get it on.
It's 1080p 30, but be warned about Koei Tecmo ports on PC. They, from what I've been told, they're not the greatest. Some of them not even being fully translated. Some of them just being, you know, just ports of like the Hong Kong version of the games or whatever. Yeah. In the case of Samurai Warriors 4-2, all they really did was give players or consumers PS4 character models, but like PS3 environments and whatnot. So they really gimped PC players. So
people might be able to mod in translations. That might happen.
Yeah, but just be aware of like the problems that their games have, because they've been very shoddy.
Right, buyer beware.
Hmm. Yes.
All right, so I think if that question is wrapped up, we can move on to the next one. So who wants to read off of that?
I'll take one since I haven't done it in a while.
Okay.
Let's see. Oh, this is a good one. Recently, Yoshida from Sony has stated that No Man's Sky was the best strategy for a PR campaign, despite liking the game itself. Do you agree with the statement, and can you reiterate why? Who wants to take that first?
I'll do it. I mean, we all knew that No Man's Sky was going to be a complete disaster PR-wise because of the promises they made about the, oh, you can go to a bazillion planets and they're all different. And then the game is about like 1,000 hours long and you can't beat it. It's like, dude, get out of here. That is impossible. There's no way that you could achieve this feat. And if you do, I mean, that would be pretty spectacular, but at the same time, it's just unrealistic. Yeah, it's unrealistic and impossible. So I think that maybe they should have scaled all that back, start thinking about realistic things, talking about the game itself. Then people wouldn't have all these wild expectations as to what to expect with the game. So I do think that it was a problem. It was a nightmare. And the game sort of flopped because of it. People called it out on a shit.
Yeah.
So, I mean, yeah, that's how it went down. That's how I feel about it. It just should have been more realistic. If you're going to have these randomly generated planets that are the same, at least sort of allude to that or say that. Don't make these grand promises that you can't keep.
And don't show in your trailers that there's these vast ecosystems with all these different various creatures on these planets. And then you get there and there's like
four different types of creatures, and it looks almost the same as a creature you found on a planet four or five planets ago, and there's not an ecosystem there at all. I have not once in 20 hours of gameplay seen one animal charging in and going after other animals and other animals running off. And, you know, it just, man, that game was such a disappointment.
The idea that the game was apparently supposed to be like, you know, generating like new planets, that wasn't like a bad idea, but to me that just kind of came off as like, oh, you know, we're going to have constant updates and, you know, we're going to try to keep everything kind of like up to date with the game and whatnot. And it doesn't really seem like that. It just kind of seems like they kind of rushed the game out and they didn't really want to live up to the expectations that people had. And it didn't help that people were overhyping that game, you know?
And I mean, even if they did try to rush the game out, there was, if you remember, there was a time when they had to delay it. And then there was that whole controversy when, what was it, Sean Murray was getting death threats and everything like that. So there's maybe even an element of that where they didn't want to get to put another delay on it.
Mm. Even still, I mean, death threats or no death threats, if you're going to delay the game and then the product you put out is inferior to what you were saying it was going to be, then yeah, it's going to be a PR nightmare. So yeah,
definitely. I mean, they literally promised the universe and that's not what we got. And I think now because of that game, procedural generation has probably gotten a bad stigma.
I don't know. I honestly think that there are going to be some developers out there that are going to take a look at the idea behind No Man's Sky, and they're going to improve upon that. And we're going to get some pretty good procedurally generated games that are similar in concept to No Man's Sky, but that are going to actually deliver what No Man's Sky couldn't. I mean, it might be a few years, but I think we'll see it.
Haven't they had fan games already?
I don't know. I just think that the whole developer diary probably on No Man's Sky was probably just a big misnomer going back and looking at it now. So I think that personally, there could be a successor that does it right. I would love to see a game that takes place in space where you can go to different galaxies and just conquer planets and actually do what that game promised, as opposed to like having all these false promises with the game.
Yeah. And you know, like, I think that's the other thing too. It's like, if you want to sell your game, you know, and you want to try to be, you know, very, you know, obviously you want to be positive about how you promote it, but what you want to do is not try to overhype it and overshoot, because then you're just going to just give a very poor expectation, I guess you can say. You're going to have overhyped expectations, and then when the game finally comes out, it's going to turn out like ass. The thing that I think also kind of became a problem after No Man's Sky release is that a lot of people, you know, they saw how that turned out, and then they were like, well, I'm never going to support, you know, Kickstarter or crowdfunded games ever again. And it's like, well, you know, how do you know that all these games are going to be bad per se? Because, you know, we still have things like Bloodstained Ritual of the Night, which is getting a ton of updates, you know, even had a demo too. So stuff like that. And then you have Shenmue 3 coming, which, you know, yeah, sure, there's not as much information as people would like, but you're still getting those constant updates. So it's kind of what it really should be is just people need to be a lot more cautious with how they spend their money. They need to really do background checks on like the developers they want to help back and whatnot, and not really just go on this whole train of, oh, well, it looks cool, therefore I should back it, you know, or everyone else is backing it, therefore I should back it.
What are we right. talking about?
We're talking Sky. About No Man's Sky.
Yeah, I think, you know, anybody that's shying away from Kickstarter and those sort of crowdfunding things because of No Man's Sky needs to, you know, just take a step back and realize that that's one game. And, you know, any crowdfunded game that ends up becoming like a quasi AAA title, the way that No Man's Sky did, with like Sony deciding to back them and hitting that $60 price point, you have to be skeptical. Because, I mean, you know it's a crowdfunded game, you know that it was from a very small studio, and then you're going to go and pay $60, you know, because, you know, you want to play it, or you might have backed it or something. But, you know, still, like, you just got to kind of take a step back and realize that this was from a small studio, and they made a lot of big promises, and they didn't deliver. You can't, like, let that one experience ruin the rest of your, you know, the potential games that could come out through Kickstarter or some sort of crowdfunding.
And I would also have to say too, it's like, definitely on like the developer's side, because I'm looking at this at a more like developer kind of standpoint and just how they should have went about this. Sometimes like a smaller scale game isn't really a bad thing. You know, if a game was made in a smaller scale and just, you know, was filled in with like tons of content and was more made about, you know, trying to make a fun game overall, I think that's just better than trying to make a big game with very big promises and very little to offer. So anyway, is there anybody else that wants to say anything on this topic, or can we move on to the next one?
Nope, I said my piece.
Alrighty, so... why don't we have Jake take the next question? If I could just recommend maybe going for like a niche question, just so that we can kind of break away from doing main questions for a little bit.
Yeah, sure. So Shovel Knight DLC Spectre of Torment is coming out in spring of 2017. Is it coming out in February too?
I don't know. Well, it's a spring, so yeah, probably in March. Probably.
When they learn, they're like, "Nope, not putting it there. Too much shit."
Yeah, they don't want to. They don't want to be. They don't want to kind of shoot themselves in the foot there. So much stuff coming out in February, but yeah, Shovel Knight. I mean, the DLC is probably going to do really well. I mean, Shovel Knight did so well on Steam anyway.
Yeah, it was great. I didn't still need to buy it. I should have bought it when it was on sale, but I guess I ran out of money.
Yeah, I have the game, but I haven't played it. But it looks like a pretty fun game in terms of it being kind of a sort of a callback to the retro side-scrolling kind of gameplay.
I think it might make a nice stream one day.
Yeah. All right, I can take this next question. Okay. So, okay. Michael Pachter claims PC gamers are racist and arrogant twits. If you're a PC gamer, how do you feel about this asshat statement about gamers like yourself?
Can this guy go shove a motherboard up his ass?
He's an idiot.
Did he actually expand upon like why he thinks that, or did he just say that?
No, he just kind of pulled a hipster fraud gamer.
Oh, okay. So... yeah, it seems like there's a lot of fucking people just saying stupid shit like that recently, just out of the woodwork, like, oh, this person's racist, yeah, etc.
Michael Pachter's just trying to stay relevant.
Yeah. Who is this guy again? Like, I've never heard of him.
He used to have a show on Game Trailers before it died.
Okay.
Hey, just as relevant as Jack Thompson.
That's right. Wait, who?
Who? What? Jack what? Jack who?
Jack Daniel, what?
Well, yeah, I could go for that.
Yeah. Yeah, it's pretty much just what it seems like. He is. It seems like he's trying to stay relevant just to stir some shit, you know.
I mean, it's working. It's getting us talking about him and stuff, yeah, but still, it's not good attention.
So.
True, it's just a really stupid thing to say.
Let's get him on the podcast.
Hell no.
So Michael, I heard you think we're racist.
Yeah, how does it feel to have that motherboard
over
your ass?
Maybe it's because I swear I've heard somebody make this argument before that PC gamers are racist because they call it the PC gaming master race.
That doesn't even
and it's not even it's a joke,
it's a joke, dude.
And even then, I mean, there are some people that are really elitist in the PC gaming, to the PC gaming side, but that's like with any community. You can't just like, make statements that way.
Consoles do that shit, like the Xbox and, you know.
Sony ponies, Nintendrones. Like, to me, personally, all I care about is gaming on the machine that I love without any bullshit practices preventing that. As long as I have my gaming rig, as long as I have my gaming consoles, I'm fine with that. I don't have to make a big case about I'm part of the master race, so I'm going to talk shit about everyone. I don't do that because I'm too focused on gaming to care. All right. Yeah.
Bring your fucking racism bullshit to gaming. That's not going to work.
I don't know what this guy is talking about, to be honest. Oh, PC gamers are racist. Like, okay, can you prove it? I bet you he can't.
It's like he just wanted to make a random outrageous statement just because.
Mm-hmm. And I'm sure you could find those people. Yeah, sure, there's always going to be bad eggs in kind of community, you know. But, you know, on the majority side of things, I don't... And not just PC gamers, but just in general, I think that, you know, you can find a lot of good things and you can find a lot of bad things. So I think that that statement is very, very ridiculous.
And it's not everyone. I mean, like you said, there's bad eggs, but at the same time, he is generalizing everyone.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that's where the problem comes in. It's all about the generalization. It's not, you know, trying to pull out like specific people within the community or whatever, you know, because that's one thing. If you were to call out specific people in the community and try to get them like blacklisted and whatnot, then that's a little bit more understandable. But when you're generalizing, you just make yourself look like an asshat.
Yeah.
So I think that was a pretty good discussion. You want to take the next question, Ren?
Hold on. Let me see here.
We've got about three niche and then one trivia niche. And about
niche
afterwards. Four or five main topics.
Let me see here. Oh, yes. I have one, actually. This is trivia. Recently, there was a website on Twitter apparently advertising that people could pay for platinums as a way to make a lucrative business towards gamers who cared about only trophy score. What do you think about lazy practices and suggestions like this to the common gamer? First of all, this is stupid. Anyone who pays for this, you're a fraud. Complete fraud. I just can't believe that there's a service like this and people pay into this for a trophy score. It's like, why don't you earn it yourself? I think that's more prideful to earn it yourself than to have someone play on your account and get that trophy.
And you mind if I add on to that really quick too?
Go ahead.
When it comes to that, well, first of all, if you're giving somebody your account and you don't even know who this person is, like, chances are they might try to steal some shit, okay? Because that's not even a foolproof, like, idea. Second of all, like, if you're trying to pay to earn a trophy, like, that's fucking dumb. Like, I could understand if you just don't want to go out of your way to do, like, online trophies, or there's some trophies that are, you know, maybe glitched, or the game has something where it's specifically under online or whatever, so they're not really, you know, they're not really good trophies or whatever, and you feel they could have been... they could have given you a better trophy list or whatever. But that said, it's like, you know, if you're not going out of your way to earn these trophies, then what's the point of playing games? You know, I put in, for example, like I put in the time, like I put in like 100+ hours into Bloodborne just to get the platinum in that game and all of the DLC trophies. I enjoyed every single hour of that game, and, you know, if I had somebody do that for me, I don't think that game would have been as enjoyable.
There's no benefit, right, to get trophies. You don't get any kind of, like, discounts, whatever. It's just, like, to have it there.
No.
Just personal pride.
No, there really isn't. The only thing that I had heard of as far as, you know, going back to Bloodborne, as far as, like, getting to platinum for that game, if you had the UK version, you would get, like, a theme. Which I'm actually kind of surprised this isn't like a standard where if you get a platinum for a game, you don't get like an exclusive theme or something like that. Because at least you'd be getting some kind of incentive to doing the platinum or whatever.
Wasn't this thing, I don't know if you guys remember, Satilius was trying super hard to get a platinum to like take a picture of it and to show it to, I think, Sony. And he was supposed to get something out of it.
It was Uncharted, I thought.
Was it?
Yeah, I don't remember. Gilius was trying to platinum Uncharted, I think.
I don't remember what he got for getting platinum, but I don't think he got it.
You were supposed to get a wallpaper.
Yeah, but I saw this website. I think you, like, was it like $100 or something for someone to platinum games?
It depends on the difficulty of the trophy. If it's very difficult, the money goes up.
Yeah, I saw one of them was like $100.
So what? They're going by the if we're going by
Going by the difficulty,
right? By PlayStation 4 trophies. So PS4. by that logic, okay, because you can't really judge by whether or not the trophy is difficult. You can only judge by how many people have gotten it. So assuming that a trophy isn't really hard to get, it's just very, you know, rare that somebody's ever gotten it, then they would be overcharging you for a trophy that might be, like, piss easy to get.
I assume the target is if the trophy is, like, ultra rare, like, no one has it. Like, and if someone has it, it's, like, very, you know, minimal in terms of the number.
Mm-hmm.
I just think that whole thing is fucking stupid. I don't know who in their right mind would do that. Like, you pay somebody, like, you're paying somebody to go into your account and, like, play a game for you and get trophies for you, so you're not really doing it yourself. And, you know, like, the whole point of trophies is just to kind of show off, and you're basically just, you know, you can't even, like, how would you even feel right showing that off knowing that you didn't even get it, you know?
Oh, someone will do it. This is the human race.
There's this sucker born every day, you know?
Somebody would, you know, just be like, oh, look at what I got, and have no shame whatsoever. But, I mean, there's, you know, that's not a self-respecting gamer. That's not a true gamer, you know. Fraud. That's somebody who's all about flash and show, and they don't have any self-pride putting in hours and hours of gameplay. You know, it's a bunch of bullshit.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I agree with that.
It's just crazy to me that services like this actually exist.
Oh, there's a way to make money on anything, man. I mean, honestly, if any self-respecting gamer were to ever use that site and actually pay the money to have somebody else go into your account and, you know, get a platinum trophy, just take your gaming rig, your PlayStation, your Xbox, whatever you're playing on, take it outside and shoot the damn thing, because you don't deserve to play it.
And you know that they're going to be like telling other people and be like, hey, look what I got and everything. It's like this. I don't see anyone doing this for them to satisfy themselves.
Yeah.
No, there's no way to be satisfied with yourself if you paid $100 for somebody else to beat a, you know, to beat a game and platinum it for you. There's no self-gratification in that whatsoever.
I would actually be very ashamed if I had somebody platinum a game for me. You know, like, it's just like, no, because I didn't put in the work to it, so how would that be satisfying at all? It would just feel like somebody else did the work. I didn't earn that. Somebody else earned that.
Yeah, I don't even like anybody else playing on my account on anything, because, you know, I just, like, you know, I mean, certain games, yeah, okay, whatever. If I've got a friend over and they don't have their system with them or whatever, I'll let them play, you know, we'll pass a controller around or something. But, like, you know, I wouldn't let one of my friends sit there and play like ranked matches on anything. Like, no, that's, you know, that's all me. I gotta earn that, you know. I'm not, you know, you can go play like free for all, quick play, whatever, on whatever game. I'm just saying, like, you know, I won't let anybody do that, let alone pay somebody money to go and play it for me.
And you know, I definitely understand. Like, my stepsister had played the Tomb Raider game. So, like, you know, if you look on my account, you can see that I have Tomb Raider trophies. But I didn't play those games. I would have to go out of my way to play those games, you know, to see. The only one that I actually did play was the reboot one, the 2013 one. That one I did actually play. But all the other Tomb Raider trophies from, like, the HD collection and whatnot, I didn't play those. So, you know, those were all from my stepsister. So I can't necessarily claim that I have earned those trophies, you know? So yeah, I definitely
get... But you were sharing a system at that time, so you can't really prevent, you know, certain things. I'm just saying, you know, I would never voluntarily let somebody else even a friend or a family member get on my account and, you know, play a game and get me trophies, even whether it was direct or indirect. I mean, I'll let them goof off on a game or something, but not to actually go on there and like get trophies. It's not happening.
Oh yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I absolutely agree.
All right. Yeah. So I think we should move on to the next one.
I want to read the, one of the niche questions, if that's okay.
Yeah, go for it. Go for
Since it. October is coming, and that means Breast Cancer Awareness Month, this question seems to be good for the moment. Senran Kagura's 5th anniversary teases a possible new game for 2017.
Oh, I thought you were going to read off Summer Lesson because you said October. No. So.
Yeah.
I figured, you know.
As soon as he brought up Breast Cancer Month, I knew where he was going with that. Yeah.
Well, you know, you kind of got titties in Summer Lesson too, but
they're gonna have the.
We might as well talk about both.
They're gonna
games
have the titty mouse pad in the collector's edition.
Okay. Yeah, Kill Two Birds with One Stone.
Yeah, you know, for Senran Kagura for a new game to come out. Well, it's cool that it's the 5th anniversary and they're gonna be celebrating that. I would be interested in playing the games. I actually do have to go back to Estival Versus because that game is really fun. And yeah, I would be interested to seeing what they would do next, especially if it's just, you know, going to improve on what they already established with the games.
All right. I have Estival Versus as well. I haven't played it. I still have it in my Steam library, but really looking forward to getting into it and see what I can dig up.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm really going to be interested in seeing what new thing that's going to make for 2017, because the games really do look interesting. That's why I bought it. So, you know.
Yeah, lewdness aside, it actually does play really well. I would argue gameplay-wise, it's a Samurai Warriors, because,
mm-hmm.
You know, it's got, like, the pause combos and aerial combos and whatnot, so it definitely has a leg over the.
Yeah, it's a very addicting game, especially if you're into Dynasty Warriors and stuff like that. That's really fun.
Hmm.
Summer Lessons seems like it's going to be pretty interesting.
What is that? Is that a VR?
Like, basically, it's a VR game where you teach a Japanese girl English and then an American girl or Western girl Japanese, I think. it is basically Japanese Perf Simulator 2016.
Yeah, I kind of figured that turned into a hentai game.
I would totally buy that if it took it a step further, but...
Yeah, I would assume that it would, but whatever. You know, it's...
Yeah. All right, calm down, Pervs. Let's move on to the next one.
yeah, you know, me and Chaos were... totally gonna take advantage of the collector's edition.
I know, he's your fat friend.
He's gonna have the wall scrolls and the fucking mouse pad and, you know, all that.
This is getting worse. We should move on.
Yeah, go on.
I'll take on the last niche question. They're officially, it's not too long, but it is extended gameplay of the Dark Souls 3 Ashes of Ariandel gameplay. Of the small amount of gameplay that's been released so far, what do you guys think of the DLC so far?
Looks great. Looks like Dark Souls. Really looking forward to it. You know, as we all know, we got like a little group in the TCP that really, really loves these games. They're really great. Really fun to do.
Looks like, yep, Dark Souls with like a lot of snow. And that's all I really noticed about it. I only saw like a little bit of the video. And
winter is coming.
Yeah. Sean, well, Dean promised us.
Yeah, I'm really looking forward to the DLC. I want it to be October already so I can play it, because I really want to play it. As far as I'm aware, they're doing like 4 new armor sets and like 16 weapons in total for the DLC. I don't know if that means that's like new stuff specifically. Well, obviously it's new stuff, but like, I don't know if they plan on like bringing back stuff that might have not like made the cut that were like, as far as like armor sets and weapons are concerned, like that might have been like in Dark Souls 1 and 2 that didn't make the cut into 3. So that could also maybe end up in Dark Souls 3 DLC, but who knows? Did everyone die?
Yes.
I was about to say, I still need to get back into Dark Souls 3. I think I met the Dragon Armor boss, so...
I'm really interested in learning, finding out what the lore is going to be for this DLC, what, you know, what new shit we're going to find out.
Yeah, for sure.
Have any opinions on the DLC?
Alright, so I think we have about 2 more questions before we call it quits, like, for tonight.
Right.
I can take one.
Alright, go ahead.
Alright, where was it? There it is. Number 12. Apparently the next Assassin's Creed game won't launch next year after adding another year for the franchise to rest in the hole. So Ubisoft CEO cited that it will be back when it's ready. That's when we feel we have something here. 2017 isn't necessarily a given for the return of the series. How do you feel about another year without Assassin's Creed? I don't really care. Yeah.
I can't live without my yearly Madden or Assassin's Creed.
No, I am thank fuck. Like, just thank fuck. I'm glad that it's on hiatus because one of two things can come out of this. One, we can just go for a couple of years without Assassin's Creed, you know, kind of let it die down a little bit, and maybe they can improve the games and actually innovate instead of removing features or bringing back features that they removed, things of that nature. So there is potential that this could be a good thing. However, they could bring this back and they could just be like, yeah, no, we're going to go back with the yearly thing. I think that was a very good thing on our end.
And no, altogether.
It's a bunch of garbage.
No, like, this is the problem with COD and Madden. It's the same crap every year. Why would they go back to that?
Hey, we're just going to make one little tweak here, one little tweak there, repackage it, and sell it to you for another $60.
You guys remember Assassin's Creed 3? I mean, that was a great fucking...
What if Desmond comes back to life? I would fucking just... I'd die. I don't want Desmond to come back.
I doubt that was going to happen.
Zombie unless... Desmond.
A remake of the first game, I'd be like, no.
Oh, man.
You're like, I'm good. I'm good.
I got Watch Dogs.
I wouldn't mind if they... Are they remastering? No, they're not remastering the first game because it's the NCO collection for the New Ages.
Which is weird. You know, they did the Ezio collection, which is really just the Ezio trilogy, which that was also kind of weird how they gave it the name change.
Yeah.
But it's weird because it's like, you know, they could be taking advantage with the first game. Unless if they're going to be like, oh, it's getting a remaster with like new content and new mechanics and whatnot.
I would like to see that because I think James was saying that the controls for Assassin's Creed 1 aren't that great.
Oh, no, the mechanics for the first one did not age well.
No, and there just wasn't a lot of content in that first game either. It just got super repetitive. Like halfway through the game, it was like, oh, I get to climb some more towers and jump into hay bales. Oh, yeah, I could sneak around and do this. But
to be fair, that's like most Assassin's Creed games.
Well, yeah, but you know, like at least with the second and third one, there was different variations of the missions. I mean, the first one, it just felt like you were doing the same thing. Every single piece of the storyline was the same kind of thing. It didn't really, I mean, the storyline progressed, but the actual gameplay and the mission and the mechanics of it all, it just all felt very repetitive.
Right. I agree because, you know, it's either you tail someone, you blend in with the crowd, you stab someone, and then you get spotted, you run away, and then it sort of repeats the process over again. Then you got to steal from somebody. Then it's the same thing in the next city. That's what happened. Like, in the next city, it's the same set of missions.
Yeah, in the end, me and my roommate at the time ended up just taking turns, basically doing what we used to do in Grand Theft Auto 3, running around and pissing as many guards off as we could, and then seeing how long we could survive.
it's essentially what we ended up doing with that game.
Mm-hmm. And with one, it's like, you know, I could see it getting improved if they like re-released it and you know, improved on the graphics, like, or like, you know, they did used Anvil Nex on it and gave all the mechanics that you have like in the later games, as far as not like some of the equipment, you know, maybe they could introduce something exclusive to that remake or whatever, but they could definitely improve on that, like the no swimming thing, like the fuck was up with that, you know? When you move on from one to two, the gameplay is definitely improved. Then two to Brotherhood, not so much, but it felt like a better game compared to two. And then Revelations was basically 2.5. And then three came out. Three had a lot of good gameplay mechanics and whatnot, but overall it was just meh. Then four was a good pirate game, and
Unity.
No, there was one before Unity. It was,
Black Flag.
Oh yeah, Black Flag. I thought you meant after that. Yeah, after that.
No. Black Flag is the fourth game.
Liberation.
Rogue.
Yeah, Rogue. That was the one.
Oh yeah.
Rogue came out. It was basically Assassin's Creed 4.5. Then Unity came out.
Oh yeah.
And then they were like, you know, we're going to go back on the thing we said about the fans not making good ideas. We might make an AC Egypt game. Yeah.
Also, damn, Dom, you just reminded me of that fucking no swimming thing. I remember when in the original Assassin's Creed 1, if you are on a perch near water and people throw rocks at you, you will fall off into the water. That happened to me.
Drown.
That happened to me plenty of times. Oh my God.
Is one of the things that I loved about the second game was the ability to kind of build up your own little city. Like, from going from the first game to the second game, that was one of my favorite additions to the game, was where you had your own city you could go back to, and as you progressed through the game and unlocked more shops and parts of it, you got extra stuff. And I thought that was like a really cool addition to the series.
Brotherhood kind of expanded on that with like Rome, where you can buy up all these shops or whatever, and then you could just keep upgrading them to like level 3 or level 4. Yeah. And you can make more income out of that the more you upgrade it, and you can get like better equipment and stuff like that. So that was pretty cool.
Assassin's Creed Monopoly.
Yeah. You know, I'm sure they have too.
Oh, I'm sure there's a Monopoly for everything.
Yeah.
All right, so I think last question of the night. Who wants to take it?
Did you read off a question? No. Why don't we have James read off the last one, actually?
All right.
Were we doing only one more?
Yeah, one more, and that's it.
Yeah. So we got 5, 6, 9, and 11.
Alrighty.
James, you're cutting out a lot, and you're...
I can read it for
you. You guys might have to go
for it. I'll take number 11. Have you tried the recently released application of PlayStation Now on the PC? What are your thoughts still on the app and more features of PlayStation showing up on PC? What would you request as a feature to port over from the PS4 app to PC? I can't really speak on this because I haven't tried PlayStation Now. I just remember that hearing PlayStation Now was kind of a sort of a mess when it was first launched, and it had like a lot of lag issues.
I don't know
if it has that same issue on the PC though.
Basically what happens is when you try it, you get the application. It's sort of similar to what was that fucking thing, Remote Play, where it's an easy interface to get involved with, but what happens is when you get inside Remote Play, the graphics look significantly downgraded. It looks all washed out, pixely, all that stuff. But if you have a good internet, and I will suggest a wire connection, it plays kind of well. I still find it very iffy on fighting games because it doesn't really feel right. It feels like, you know, you're losing 3 frames a second, and that's not good. So I played it, and you know, I thought it held up for the most part. Like I said, the application was very, you know, streamlined. You could see everything perfectly. You didn't have to set up like 3,000 things to get it to work properly. It's just that it has that sort of downgrade in graphics and it feels finicky in some games, but otherwise it's okay, but it's not ideal. The streaming games is not ideal yet, in my opinion, at least. I think that it still needs some ironing out before we get to that point of fully doing it.
That's like what happened with OnLive. It was kind of a completely failed service.
That's what I was going to bring up. Yeah, OnLive, that was a failure.
I also tried at the same time Renegade did, and I was just like, eh, just play it on PS3. Just get a PS3. You don't need PS now.
Yeah, I've never tried it because I have a PS3 still, so there's no real point.
Yeah, it's like, eh. And if you're going to freaking try out the free trial, please, don't fall to the same trick I did. I got charged because I didn't fucking deactivate my account there.
Oh, yeah, they will gouge you for that money if you don't cancel your membership on time.
Gonna do that right now after this podcast.
Do they at least give you a refund?
Yeah. You're talking about PlayStation Plus or PlayStation Now?
PlayStation Now.
They do that with PlayStation Plus as well.
Yeah.
From what I remember.
Yeah, they auto-renew. You need to turn off your auto-renew. Yeah,
you can turn off the auto-renew, but for whatever reason, I noticed that like mine keeps getting turned back on after I turn it off. So I would just suggest taking your card off after every purchase.
Are you sure you don't want to give us $60?
Yeah, super sure. Don't fucking steal money out of my account.
Well, we're gonna charge your account just because we don't know if you're sure or not. So you're gonna, we're gonna have you.
You can cut it off from the quick menu when you go to your account. So it's right there when you go to account billing. You can just say cancel auto renew. But yeah, that shit did happen to me before with I think it was PS Now. It happened to me once. I'm like, man, I had to pay $20 to these assholes, and I didn't want to do this.
I know this is diverging a bit, but I'm seriously considering like just canceling my PlayStation Plus because there's really no reason to keep it at this point.
It's really not.
It continues to fail to impress me with just the games they come out with every month,
And they increased the price too, right? Something like that.
Yep, they did.
Yeah.
Yeah, $10. It's $60 now. For the year, anyway.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I think yeah, like Ren was saying, this is a good point to cut off. So,
yep. Sorry to do those outros.
Right, so we're going to do outros. So I'm going to let Jake go first, and then we'll move on from there.
So how do you guys go about it?
Say like, where can we find you? What do you do, like, on Twitter and YouTube, stuff like that?
Okay. So yeah, my name is Jake. You can find me on Twitter at JakeMistake with an underscore at the end. I do a YouTube channel where I do a segment called Mistake or Must Buy. It's basically a review channel. That's basically what I'm doing right now. Working on Phoenix Wright Spirits of Justice review coming out in the next couple of days. Thanks.
Okay. So who's next, Dom?
That would be Reapers is next.
Okay.
All right. You can find me on Twitter and on Twitch and YouTube at Reapers240, where I occasionally be doing things on my own time when I have time. But you can find me on my Twitter there if you want to talk or do whatever.
Right. James, what's your outro, buddy?
Yep, there you go.
Yeah.
You can find me on Twitter at dev.hunterjames.
In case if you didn't hear, it's at dev.hunterjames on Twitter, and then on Twitch it's the hero James. So next we'll have Smoke go.
You can find me on Twitter and on YouTube at 563 gaming, and I mostly do let's plays and game reviews.
Alrighty. And then, Chaos, where can we find you?
You can find me on Twitter at Captain Chaos, and you can find me on YouTube by the same name. That is with a space in between, though, Captain Chaos. Mostly do Let's Plays and game reviews and some other stuff just to have some variety. But yeah, if you're interested in that, check me out.
And you guys can find me as at biodevil_dom on Twitter. I'm also that name on YouTube, and then on Twitch it's dom24 1996. So last but not least, where can we find you, Ren?
You can find me on Twitter at rentoperative_. You can find me on YouTube at renegadeoperative, where I will be ranting about certain heroic site on YouTube that was pretty stupid. So if you want to see my rant on YouTube Heroes, you can find that. I'm going to be trying to get more podcasts uploaded. I think that the Assassin's Creed discussion is going to be pretty good, in my opinion, along with the other stuff. If you people want to see what we're doing, you can offer suggestions. So I'm going to put that in the description of this video as well as the event planner so you guys can see it and see what we're up to. Some pretty cool stuff in there. But for now, this is the end of this podcast. Pretty informative. I have some great guests. And I like to talk to all you later. So see you out there in YouTube land.
Yep. See ya.
See ya.
Take it easy.